installation of our programming language Python itself, that how to install Python. So for that you simply need to go over to your browser, and over here you need to just type on download Python, and the very first link that you will get over here, python.org. From here you can get the Python downloaded into your system. It will be an executable file. You just need to run that executable file and your Python will be installed in your system. Second installation was of the workspace, of the place where you are going to write the code, that is the IDE. The IDE we are using throughout the course is PyCharm. So to download PyCharm in your system, you can just go over to your browser again and download PyCharm. You have to search over here. PyCharm comes in two variants, one is paid version and one is community version. So you can go over to the very first link over here, jetbrains.com, and over here you can just simply see two of these versions. One is the this professional version is the paid version along with Python support. It also provides you different supports of another things. You can get that as well if you want these supports. Otherwise, the free version is perfectly fine. You can download the Python PyCharm from here. It will be an executable file. You need to run the executable file and PyCharm will be installed into your system. And the third important installation was of Selenium itself, that how to work with Selenium and all. So Selenium is easy to install. You just need to go over to a URL, that is selenium.dev. That's the one place solution for all your questions. If you want to read about Selenium, you want to learn about it, you want to see how, what versions came out, everything you will find on this website only. You need to go over to download section over here and scroll down a little. You will find a table like this over here. In here, the languages which support Selenium are given over here with their stable versions. We are concerned about Python right now, so we'll go over here and click on download. And this is the command that has been given to us. Where to run this command, what this command is. You have to run this command on the command prompt itself. And this command is simple. This PIP is basically a package manager which is provided to you. Okay, can I? Yes, you can join the meeting from your mobile as well. And if there are any more participants which are to be joined, they will join in between and they will catch up. There is no issues on that. Okay. Okay, and if you're using Python version 3 above, then you need not to install this pip from anywhere. It is already in the package, so you just need to go over to your command prompt and run this command, simply pip install Selenium, and Selenium will be installed into your system. Okay, now over here, coming to the second session, what we have done in the second session was that how using the Selenium commands we can open up different browsers, right? Now when we talk about browsers, why are we opening browsers first? Because what Selenium does is it automates the browser. Whatsoever you want to do on your browsers, it can be automated, and the very first step to do that is to open the desired browser you want. You can automate Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Opera, Safari, Internet Explorer, any of the browser you want. You can just simply automate them. This is the one line command to open up the browser. This is for Internet Explorer. If you want to open any another browser, then there are options over here, like I just will show you. Here is the help. The classes that are coming up in the first alphabet as capital, they are the browser names. Rest are the another packages which are used, but which if you want to open up the browser directly, then the first capital letter is the function that you have to use. Like this Edge, yes. Yes, I am able to hear you. It's okay. So, if you have to open up any browser, you can simply look up from here. Like, if I want to open up Chrome browser, or let's say I want to open up Edge browser, then I'll simply will say Edge followed by a pair of parentheses. I'll save this and I'll run this function. I'll run this module or file. Module and file, one are the same thing. Don't get confused if I use any of the another word. They are same. This is the only command, and here is my Edge browser opening up like this, right? But if you do the same thing in your system for the very first time, you may get some error, because whichever browser you are opening, it needs to have a driver into the system, which is provided by the browser provider itself. So how to download those drivers, that was covered in the second class. It's easy for Chrome and Edge. It's very important that you download the drivers according to the version. Right, so if you want to check the version of Edge or Chrome, you can check it from these options, Help and About the browser, Edge or Chrome, whichever you're using. You can look it from here. Right, this is the version. Now you can simply go back to the main, to the one solution that I told you, that this is the one place solution. In here you will find the solution to get the drivers. Just go over to the API docs, the documentation, and in here scroll down to this page. You will get to this documentation page, and over here you will get a section of drivers. Right now we are working for the Chrome, so there is the link given to get the driver of Chrome. So if I open up this link, I will be routed to this page. On this page, so far as many as versions for Chrome are released, the drivers are available according to the version. I'm repeating it again. The versions are very important for Chrome and Edge. If they mismatch, or if the version in your system is 87 and the driver is 86, then your Chrome browser may not open and you may get an exception. So it's important to check for the version. I had 87.0. So if I had to have my driver, I will be going to this link to download it. Right. Once I'll click on this link, I will be routed to this page. According. Yes. Yeah. In case of Chrome, that's not true. In case of Firefox, that is fine. Because in case of Chrome, you may get exception that the session is not created, the driver is not up to the mark, or the browser is not up to the mark. Okay? Yeah. So it's important over here. According to the system configuration, you can download it from here. A zip file will be given to you. Extract it out and keep the executable file for Chrome driver at the place where it is suitable to you. Okay. Likewise, you can do it for Edge as well. For Edge, you can simply go over here. Let me go back to this page. For Edge, there is the link given. For Firefox, the link is given over here. Okay, now for Edge, it's exactly the same that we have done in the Chrome. You have to look for the version and download the browser. But in case of Firefox, it's little different. Why is it so? Because whenever a new version of Firefox comes up, at the same time, the drivers are not released. They are released a little later on. So that's why what we do is we make sure that my browser, my Firefox, my default Firefox does not get automatically updated when the new version comes. I'll wait for the driver and then only I'll update my Firefox. That is what we need to do in case of Firefox. You can simply go over to your default Firefox browser. In here, you just have an option of stopping the automatic update from here. You can see I am not also using the current version. I haven't checked whether the browser driver has came or not, but if it has, I'll update my browser. From where you can stop the automatic update, you'll get a section of Firefox updates over here. Over here you need to check the second radio button, that is check for updates, but let you choose when to install. Alright, once it is done, you can just go over to this page and over here go to this link and scrolling down you will get the drivers of Firefox. They have named the driver as Geeko driver, the browser provider. So you will get it from here according to your system configuration. You can download the zip files from here. Extract the executable file out of the zip file and keep it at the location where you have kept the other drivers of your browsers. Okay. Once the drivers are downloaded into your system and you have kept them at a location, then you can just use this command. And in here, in the command, you have to pass on the path of that driver where you have kept it in your system. You have to pass on that path, and that path is basically, you just need to say executable path. This is a parameter which you will be passing, followed by the path of the driver in your system, right? So where I have it is, I have it in my C drive. So I'll just will take the path. Yeah. One more thing about Microsoft Edge. By default, the name of the driver is something else. It's something like MS Edge Web Driver, like that the name is. So what you need to do is, you need to change the name of your driver to Microsoft Web Driver. Like I have done it. You have to do it this way. Okay, I'll tell you why I'm saying so and what's the reason of doing so. I'll just will tell you in some time. Till which part you're asking about? Yeah. By default, when you download the driver of Edge, the name of the driver is something like MS Edge driver. Like that the name is. You have to rename the driver to Microsoft Web Driver. The way I have given it, you can see it on the screen. Microsoft with capital M, W with capital and D with capital. Right, you have to rename it in this way. Why is it so? I'll just will tell you in a few seconds. I'll tell you right now. This command is complete. If you run this command now in your system after downloading the drivers and run this, your Microsoft Edge browser will be opening, as in my case it's opening. Right. Now the question comes up that do we have to provide the path of the driver every time we are opening the browsers? So the answer to this question is no. Why is it? What we can do is, we have kept all the drivers in a single folder, right? So what I can do is, I can set up this folder into my environment variables once and for all. Whenever I'll update it, it will be updated in my system variables automatically. I don't have to change anything, no path to be given, right? I just will go into my environment variables. And in here you'll get a variable path, edit this and add up the folder in which you have kept all the drivers, like I have done it over here. So as many as drivers are there, I can open any browser I want. Click this OK, click all the three OKs, and that's good to go. Then what you can do is, you can remove this path that you have given, and now we have come up to that single line command where I can open up any browser. Okay. Now the reason why I told you to rename the Edge browser is that there's something wrong with the command or something wrong with the driver. If you haven't renamed your file, you have to give the path every time you want to open the Edge browser, even if it has been added into your environment variables. Right, if you haven't changed the name of your driver, in that case only. But if you have renamed it, then it's good to go. You can give this command like this, and your Edge browser will open as it was opening before. Okay, you can try it with another browsers. Like if I want to open up Firefox browser, then also I can just go on and I can say Firefox and run. So it will be running up like this. My Firefox browser has been opened up. Okay, clear? Any questions? Yeah, it was in the path variable. I'll show you again. Just wait. In the system variables, just go to this variable path, edit this and add up your folder. Just click on new and add up your folder path. Okay. Welcome. So this was what we have covered in the last two sessions. By this only, what we can do is we can simply, once we have opened up the browser, right? What next step will be? To go on to some website, right? I can open up any website that I want to. So there is command as well. But since WebDriver is a class that we are using, I cannot make a hanging object which does not have a reference, and I have to make object again and again. Just to avoid that, what we do is we make a reference to this object WebDriver, so that I can use the reference driver to use throughout the course. Right now, if I have to open up the URL, so I won't be calling webdriver.firefox.open the URL. I won't do that. I'll just will use my driver variable, and I'll just will have the functions associated with that, with the WebDriver class. So what function I am concerned about is to open up the URL. So for that, I have the function get. This is my function. To this get function, I can pass on any URL that I want to. Like suppose I want to pass on www. In the double quotes, you have to give it. So let's say I want to go to facebook.com. Let's say. So I'll save this and I'll run this. So my Firefox browser opened up and it will be navigating me to facebook.com like this. Easy enough. This way I can open up any URL I want to open. Right. Now I don't want to go into much of the Selenium commands right now. What I was supposed to cover in this video is another package which will help me to make the test cases. Right, we're going to automate the browsers, we are going to test the functioning of a browser, right? So we'll be making the test cases out of it. How to do that? So for that we use another package, and that package is basically, the name of that package is PyTest. This is a package specifically for the test cases to be made. It has some convictions, some rules to be followed. If you don't follow those rules, your test cases are not going to be executed, nor they are going to be considered as a test case. They are just going to be considered as a normal file that we were running till now, a normal file we will running now. Now we want our test case to run. So how to do that? What are the rules? So let's discuss the rules first, and then we'll come to the installation, how to install it and that. So there are three rules basically. They are just the naming conventions that you need to be careful about. First one, the file name that you are going to give, that should always start from test underscore, the file name that you are going to create, the Python file. Right, it should always have the test underscore prefixed before the name of your test case. Ahead it, you can add anything like test demo, test dummy, test chrome, whatsoever you want, but test underscore needs to be prefixed. Alright, the second rule is the creation of a test case. Now, what a test case is and what actually a test class is. Basically, test case is a function that we make. The creation of test case is same as the creation of function. We make it by the keyword def followed by the name of the test case. The same is the way we create the functions. What the difference is, we need to prefix test underscore in front of the test case, in front of the name of my function. I can name it anything like function 1. So this will be my first test case that will be made. If I'll remove this test underscore, it will be normal function that we use. Okay, and the third rule is also the same thing. That is for the class, that how we make the classes in Python the same way. The keyword is class again to create a class. And for this, how to make a test class by prefixing test with a capital T. Okay, these are the three rules that you need to follow while making a test class, test function or a test module. Okay, we will be following these and then we'll be running few of our dummy cases and then we'll see most of the things about PyTest. Okay, now the rules are understood to us. We need to install PyTest into our system. So it's not that big thing. You can go over to your browser and look for download PyTest. So the official link to get all the PyTest related documents, like in coming times we will be using more of the packages related to PyTest only. So there is one place for that, that is pypi.org. This is the official link. And in here on this site, it gives you just a command. The same way it gave you the command to install Selenium, the same way. And you have to same way run the same command that you have done to install the Selenium. You'll just will copy it, go to your command prompt, and in here just run this. In my case, this package is already installed, so it is going to say requirement already satisfied. In your case, it's going to install it and will let you know the information about. Okay. The versions are not to be worried about. The latest versions, the stable versions are only downloaded in by the commands which are given over here. So you are not to be worried about the versions. This is the version that has been installed. So that will come up over here. Now, PyTest is installed into my system. I have to use it to run a test case. So what's specific over here is that whenever you are making the use of some external package, right? PyTest is an external package. We have installed it exceptionally. So you have to set up the PyTest configuration over in the IDE PyCharm as well. You have to import here as well. So that you can do from here, from File, Settings, Python Interpreter. You can see over here that Selenium also is an external package that is imported over here in my project. So that is why I'm able to use Selenium. Otherwise, if you don't use these steps, you will get an error that Python is, this package is not a recognized package, right? So this step is important for all the external packages. So you need to do it first. Now I'll just will search the name of the package that I want to import, that is PyTest. I'll click on install. So it will take a while. It's done. And over here in the list, it will come up over here, all the relevant packages to PyTest that will come. I'll click on OK and done. Now I'll just will go on making a new package. And in here, following these convections only, I'm going to make my first test case. So I'll just will make Python file. The first convection says that the module name, the file name should start with test underscore. So that will be test underscore demo one, let's say, my file name. I'm just going to copy these convections from here and put it here. Okay, now I'll make a test case directly, that is my test function itself, not a class. So I'll say def test underscore dummy. And in here I can do anything. I can open up, let's say I want to open up Chrome browser. webdriver.chrome, and on Chrome I want to go to some URL, let's say google.com. Right, now I'll save this file. There are a few ways to run it. You can run it either from the Project Explorer, that is on the left side. You can click on the file name and you will get option of run, or either from here you can just go on in the configuration. It has not came, just a minute. File settings, PyTest. Okay, it should come. Why is it not coming? Let me just restart my PyCharm. There might be some issue. Let me just make one more package. Let's see. It's not coming up over here. Might be something is wrong in the PyTest. Why is it not coming up over here? My run configurations. Whenever we run it and we make some of the PyTest thing, at that time we get an option over here. When we click this right click, we get an option of run PyTest in this module. That's not coming up over here. Might be something is wrong or something like that. So that I'm trying to figure out, but that's not coming up. Let me just delete the configuration. Okay, this one. That also we can do, but from, yeah, that That also I can do. Just let me go to this location. But the thing is that from here also I can run. I wanted to show you that way, but that's not coming up. I don't know why. Show in Explorer. So I need to be at this location where my PyTest is lying. So I'll just will go on and I'll say and from here I can say PyTest. There is a one line command that I can run. This way my test case is running. Yes. Yes, I'm okay, no issue. Okay, no issues. Can you see the command prompt now? Okay. So whenever we want to run our test cases from the command prompt from the terminal, there is a one line command, one word command that we give, that is PyTest. If you have some of the print statements, some standard outputs that you want to get printed on your console, for that you can use a marker over here, that is hyphen s. Like, I have not introduced any print statement. Let me introduce a print statement over here and I'll say print my first test case. This is a print statement that I want to get printed and I want to see it on my console as well. So I will add hyphen s marker over here to see this print statement. I'll press enter and it will collect that test case. Yes. Okay, just let me know when you can see the command prompt. Okay, so this way you can just give this command and you can see the output coming up. But I didn't directly wanted to show you this. I just wanted to run it from here. I am not sure what's wrong. Maybe I have to see it again or something. Anyways, okay, this way also you can run. There are another ways. If you have, you can make multiple test cases in a single file if you want. Like over here there is only test dummy, right? I can make more of the test cases in the same file. I can say def test underscore dummy one and in here I can make more of the test case. Like I'll say again print my second test case. This way I can also do. But in any case, I don't have used the convections that we have discussed till now. I don't prefix this test underscore in front of the second test case that I have made. I forgot to do that. So it is not going to consider the second test case as a test case. It's not going to run that. Simply, it's not going to run that. So you need to be careful about the naming conventions. Whichsoever you are going to make, a function or a test, you need to be careful about that. Okay. The same way is that if you are using these, you can skip the test cases also if you want. But for that, you need to use the annotations. You want to skip some test case, you will use the annotation @PyTest. Let's import this. Import dot mark dot skip. You can complete this command by following a message. You can pass on my message if you want, like just skipping the test case. Simply you can add this if you want. Otherwise, if you don't want to add it, you can just skip it. Right? If I just see it now. Configurations. It's not coming up over here. Let's not waste time over here. I'll show it on command prompt. There are two test cases of mine. On one of the test case, there is a annotation marked, which is to skip that test case. So if I'll press enter, it will collect two test cases. Okay, it collected only one test case. Okay. Just wait. My package is now it collected two test cases. One was in which I was opening Chrome browser and going to google.com, but now that one has been skipped, and this S that is coming up over here, that's the indication that my test case has been skipped, and this green dot means the test case has been passed. If it has been coming up as F, that means your test case has been failed. There are the three indications that you can see. This is the second test case output that is coming, my second test case, the print statement, and the same is coming up over here, that one passed, one skipped in this much seconds. Okay, likewise there are number of operations that we can do using okay, can you see the screen now? Can you see the command prompt screen now? Okay, no issues. I'll just will run it again. Okay, you can see the command prompt screen. I'll run it again. I'm giving the same command, pytest, followed by marker hyphen s, just to see the print statement, because in the second test case I only have a print statement used. Right, so I'll just will press enter, and this is what I have got. It collected two items because my test cases were two over there. Suppose there is the test case, this test case, test dummy, the second test case I made, it is not prefixed by test underscore, it's just a normal dummy one test case that has been made. I have not followed the convection, then how it's going to react? So I'll go back to my command prompt. Guys, able to see the command prompt now? So I'll just will execute the same command, and now this time it says collected only one item. It did not recognize the second test case, that was test dummy function. The second test case I have made, it did not recognize this function, because PyTest has a different functionality. It recognizes the test case just by the convections that we follow. If you don't follow the convections, the test case is not going to be identified at all. Okay, so this is something that you need to be sure about. Yes, exactly. That's similar to that only. Just that in TestNG, I'm not actually very much sure about. I have known about the annotation only. I'm not sure about the file convections, that how you name the files. But in here, the file convections are also important. Like suppose over here, I have one of the test case. This is my test file, test demo 1. Suppose I have one more file over here in the same package, which I have named not according to the convention of PyTest. I just named it as demo 2, a simply. And inside this function, inside this file, I'm having the same thing that I have done in the first file. I'll just will copy the whole, and that's it. Right, now if I run the same command on my command prompt, because I'm running the whole on my package. There is a package test cases, and I'm running it on this. So it's going to collect all the files which are named according to the convictions. So I'll run it. I'll give the command pytest underscore. Now see, it's not going to pick up the second file that is named as demo 2. It's just going to pick test demo 1. So this is also very important that all the conventions are to be followed, be it a name convention of a file or a function. Okay? Any questions, any doubts in this part? Okay. Likewise, there are many things that we can do in the PyTest. We can group the test cases. We can parameterize the test case. We can take screenshots and attach it in the reports as well. But to show that all, I need to make sure that my PyCharm is also able to run the test cases, which it's not running right now. I don't know what's wrong with it. I'll see to it. And we'll definitely will cover this rest of the PyTest functions, which are important, by the next class. Okay, will that be fine to you? Okay then. So this is all. I'll request you guys to practice this. Set your system with the PyTest and do these small things. Make your test cases by your own. Practice it and see how it actually reacts. If you don't follow the convictions, if you follow the convictions, and do everything. Okay? So I'll see you in the next class. It's okay. Sure. You'll get the recording. I'll update my team as well, so that you can get the recordings of last two classes as well. And then you can watch through them as well. Okay?